So, in this video segment, I'm going to talk about what's called the theory of liquidity preference. And this was invented by Keynes, who's the sort of founder of modern macroeconomics, short-run modern macroeconomics. And the idea here is, what causes people to want to hold liquid money? Now, we already have one way of looking at this that went back to the idea of the classical theory of money demand, and that was the idea that money demand is proportional to the price level and real GDP divided by this idea of the velocity of money. So that's the idea of classical money demand, where money is a function, money demand is a function of the price level. Now, we think that that's probably true and important, and we think that this is probably especially true and most relevant in the long run, when the price level has time to adjust. But the whole thing about short-run macroeconomics is that the price level doesn't have time to adjust. So money supply and money demand aren't going to be able to come into balance as a result of the price level. So instead, theory of liquidity preference looks at money demand as a function of the nominal interest rate. And we're going to now be talking about what's sometimes called the money market. And the money market is the idea of what is the interest rate on very short-term loans, something like, 30-day, 90-day loans. And our model of the money market is going to go ahead and have the nominal interest rate on this axis, and the quantity of money on this axis. And we think that when interest rates are high, people are going to try to economize on their use of money because they don't want to have to pay to borrow that money, or they would rather put their money in a savings account where it gets an interest rate that's pretty high. But when interest rates are low, then people want to demand more money. They're more willing to have money just sort of sit there in their checking account because they're not passing up on very much interest by having it sit there. And then we think that the actual nominal interest rate in equilibrium is determined by where the money supply curve intersects the money demand curve. So there's our predicted equilibrium interest rate. And this is one way of understanding that interest rate effect that I talked about in the last video. So, a given level of interest rate is going to produce a given level of GDP demanded. In particular, when interest rates are relatively high, then that discourages all kinds of economic activity, discourages consumers borrowing, discourages businesses borrowing to finance investment. So GDP is relatively low. As the money supply grows, then that's going to go ahead and give us a lower interest rate here, and people are going to be willing to demand more GDP even at the same price level. So a change in the money supply causes a change in the aggregate demand curve. So far, so good. And maybe we could even shift it out all the way to, you know, M3 over here. And that would get us yet another aggregate demand curve. But notice there's a potential issue that comes up that we might eventually run into a situation where we push the money supply out, and we push it out so far that it's greater than the amount people demanded. And so interest rates are already at 0%, and further increases in the money supply don't do much to increase aggregate demand. And this is what's known as the zero lower bound problem. The idea is that interest rates are bounded, they're limited at zero. That's as low as they can go. So increases in the money supply can produce increases in the aggregate demand curve up to a certain point, but then further increases in the money supply may not do much. So this shift from AD3 to AD4 is relatively low. So after interest rates already zero, further increases in money supply do little to increase aggregate demand. So again, that's the idea of the zero lower bound problem. All right, so that's the overall idea of monetary policy. Monetary policy is the idea that we can use a change in the money supply to influence the level of aggregate demand. In that last slide, you saw that an increase in money supply causes lower interest rates. And if we were going to track the actual components of GDP that are impacted, we think that it's going to increase consumption spending because consumers are going to find it cheaper and easier to borrow to finance, or at least they're going to find the rewards to saving are going to be lower. And it's also going to increase investment spending by firms because they can more easily finance to borrow and execute their investment projects. Another thing is that lower interest rates make the U.S. less attractive for foreign investors because their money now earns a lower rate of return. So this makes U.S. assets less appealing. And in turn, that's going to mean that there's less demand for U.S. assets and therefore less demand for U.S. dollars. So we're going to get a weaker dollar versus foreign exchange. This will in turn cause U.S. exports to go up and U.S. imports to go down. So we can see all of these things over here are going to push up aggregate demand, and all of those things are also going to push up aggregate demand. So this is what happens if we have what's called an expansionary monetary policy. So an expansionary monetary policy has as its objective increasing aggregate demand. And that's typically what we would want to do if we wanted to try and get out of a recession. We could also run a contractionary monetary policy, where basically everything's going to go in reverse. A contractionary monetary policy has as its objective decreasing inflation, whereas this one had as its objective increasing GDP. Of course, there was a side effect here that if we increase aggregate demand, we're also going to make inflation worse. There's going to be a side effect here that we're going to go ahead and cause GDP to go down. And essentially, everything is the opposite here. So an expansionary monetary policy, we have an increase in the money supply. A contractionary monetary policy, we're going to have a decrease in the money supply. Remember that an increase in the money supply is accomplished by the Federal Reserve or other central bank buying U.S. government bonds in an open market operation. A contractionary monetary policy is executed by the Federal Reserve selling U.S. government bonds in an open market operation. So if it sells bonds, that's going to go ahead and push bond prices down and push interest rates up. We could also use that theory of liquidity preference model and shift the money supply curve to the left and see that the interest rate would move up in that diagram. Higher interest rates are going to tend to depress people's consumption spending. Either they won't borrow as much, or they'll maybe even actually save more. It's also going to discourage firms from engaging in investment projects because their costs of capital have gone up. These higher interest rates make U.S. assets more appealing to foreign investors because when they put their money in U.S. bonds, for instance, they get a higher rate of return than they otherwise would. They're going to need U.S. dollars to buy U.S. bonds, and so they're going to need to buy U.S. dollars, and the dollar is going to rise versus foreign currencies. That is going to tend to push U.S. exports down and push U.S. imports up. And you can see all of these are going to combine to cause aggregate demand to go down. So, and we have the sort of effects here on prices and output up top.